Okey diyoruz. En son ne oldu? Bölüm Tekam'ın bir konu hakkındaki konuşmasıyla başladı. Tekam dediğimiz karakter de Ezop, Mevlana'msı bir şey. Yani nasıl bir şey? Hani bir şekilde yaşadıkları hayatta deneyimleri çok olduğu için bir şeyleri anlamaya başlamış. İnsanlar hani bu durumda felsefeciler ama onların söylediği şeyler daha böyle derinlere iniyor. Direkt böyle insanın yüreğine hitap ediyor falan desem olmuş olur mu bilmiyorum. Hani felsefeciler ne yapıyor? Felsefeciler bir şeyde açık buluyorlar. O açığı deşeleyip o açığın ne gibi sonuçlar doğurabileceğini incelerken argümanlarda benim bu bahsettiğim Tekam olsun, Sokrates de böyle, Mevlana falan, Ezop, bu insanlar hayatı yaşıyorlar, bir sürü şey geçiyor bunların başından ve bir yerden sonra hani böyle o bütün o yaşadıkları suratlarına olsun, çizgi çizgi, bakışlarına, duruşlarına olsun her şeyine yansıyor. Ve bu insanlar böyle paso bilgelik konuşuyor oluyorlar. Hani böyle ağızlarından çıkan her lafın böyle bir enteresanlığı oluyor ve şöyle bir düşününce ya da işte belli bir süre yaşadıktan sonra görünce doğru olduğu anlaşılıyor falan. Tekan böyle bir tip. Bayağı Ramiz Dayı gibi bir şey. Sabahtan beri anlatmaya çalışıyorum. Ramiz Dayı. Okey. Tekam demiş ki sırlar hakkında işte iki tarz sır vardır. Hani en baş sırrın ne olduğunu söylüyor ve sır dediğimiz olay hani mysteries, cacturt falan bunlar sırra girmiyor. Mysteries derken neyden bahsediyoruz? Hani hayatın bir anlamı var ama biz bunu bilmiyoruz. Az insan biliyor. İşte bu az insan bunu çözmüş oluyorlar. İşte bu hayatın sırrı cacturt dememiz Tekam'a göre yanlış. Tekam'a göre sır dediğimiz olay bir doğruyu biliyor bir insan ve bu doğruyu saklıyor. Başka bir şeye sır demiyoruz. Bu açıdan hani böyle net bir ayrım yapmış oluyor. İşte bu mysteries olsun. Aklıma başka örnek gelmiyor. Neyse bu tarz böyle bu eksentrik, mistik, esrarvari, gizemli konular sır sayılmıyor. Sır dediğimiz şey bir şeyi biliyoruz ve onu söylememeyi tercih ediyoruz. Sonra ilerleyen sayfalarda hani bu arada ilk ve bölümün başında Tekam okumadık. Kvot Tekam okumuş zamanında Kvot bize anlatıyor bunları. Direkt şey diyoruz hani bir şekilde bir alakası var. Belki şu an okuduğumuz bölümle var. Belki bundan önceki bölümde olanlarla var falan. Bir şahsi. Tekam işte iki çeşit sır var diyor. Bir tanesi ağzın sırrı, bir tanesi yüreğin sırrı diye. Ağzın sırrı işte komşu bir şey yapıyor. Bizim dikkatimizi çekiyor. Biz böyle kendimizi tutamayıp kendi arkadaşlarımıza anlatmaya başlıyoruz falan. Dedikodu diyor. Hani bu böyle söylemezsek bizi çatlatıyor ve bunu söylemesi çok kolay. Ağzımızdan kaçıveriyor falan. Ama öte yandan yüreğin sırrı, biz bu sırrı ölümüne saklamaya hazırız. Ve bu sırrı anlatsak aslında iyi olacağımızı biliyoruz gibi ama öte yandan anlatması o kadar zor ki kesinlikle böyle bir sırrım var çok net anlıyorum onun için. Böyle bu sır gittikçe ağırlaşmaya başlıyor bizim yüreğimize ve Tekam diyor ki işte bir insanın ağız dolusu zehiri ağzına tutması daha iyi diyor böyle bir sırrı kalbinde tutmasından çünkü bir yerden sonra o kadar ağırlaşıyor ki bu sır o insan ölüyor, o insan yok oluyor, mahvoluyor. Cacürt dedi. Hani bu Kvot bunu anlatırken kendinden mi bahsediyor? Hani kendinden bahsediyor sanırım. Başka kimden bahsedecek ki? Hani geçen bölümde olan şeyleri düşünüyorum. Dena çok büyük bir sırdan bahsediyorum gibi bir havada değildi. Dena'yı takip etti. Kvot bunu biliyor. Bu yüreğinin sırrı bu mu? Evet bu yüreğinin sırrı oluyor. Çünkü bu işte söylese oh söyledim de rahatladım diyeceği bir şey değil. Dene'ye bunu söyleyecek olsa Dena'yla ilişkisinin çok net bir şekilde zarar göreceğini biliyor. Belki böyle direkt o an ayrılmalarına varacak bir şekilde hani böyle ortada bir ilişkilerin olduğu yok. Eyvallah ama sonuçta bir iletişimleri var ve o iletişim bile orada da kalmayacak. Okay, sanırım bundan dolayı anlattı. Böyle bir buçuk sayfa falan çok tatlı, çok gerçek hisli bir yer okuduk üstüne uzun uzun konuştuk. Sonra bölüme döndük. Bunlar Dena ile buluştular ve Dena böyle yanında harpini getirmiş. Üstüne çok güzel bir elbise giymiş. Böyle bacağı macağı görünüyor. Baya baya ama öte yandan ayakkabı giymemiş falan. Hani bir yandan güzel olmak için uğraşmış ama bir yandan aşırı da güzel olmak için uğraşmamış. Ayakkabısız dolaşıyor. Hobbit gibi. Neyse böyle çok hafif bir tatlış sayılacak sanırım bir şekilde utangaçlıkla Kavat'a diyor ki hazır yaptığım müzik işte sana dinletmek istiyorum. Sana çalmak istiyorum. Fikrini duymak istiyorum. Cırt cırt gibisinden. Kavat diyor ki ama diyor işte sizin Patreon'unuz aranızda değil mi bu, hani sorun çıkmaz mı sence? Dana diyor ki ben zaten bu şarkıyı çalacağım bir sürü yerde ve bu şarkı meşhur olacak. Yani şarkının amacı bu. Artı sen de gidip işte şarkının sözlerini bağıra çağıra dolaşmazsan söyleyerekten hani böyle çok da sorun olacağını düşünmüyorum. Kavat dedi tamam sorunlar, yürümeye başladılar. Kavat da ne dedi ki Meyer'i kendi patron olarak görme hakkında ne düşünürsün dedi. Dan dedi ki işte ne benim zaten bir patronum var falan, biraz ters yaptı. Çünkü Dana'nın hayatına çok direkt bir müdahale olmuş oluyor burada. Dana öyle direkt müdahaleleri sevmiyoruz. Bu durumda Kvot'a yaptığı ters anlaşılır. Sonuçta Kvot demeye devam etti. İşte Mayer bayağı güçlü bir insan. İşte senin patronun seni dayak yemekten kurtaramadıydı. Şeyde Treban'dı değil mi o ara? İlk kitabın sonundaki o Drakus'la dövüştükleri yerde. İşte o köylülerin ne bileyim dik dik bakışlarından, sana kötü davranışlarından kurtaramadıydı. Ama Mayer senin patron olsaydı o sırada köylerin hiçbiri sana hiçbir şekilde bu tarz bir şey yapamazdı falan dedi. Haklı diyoruz. Ama Dana'nın kendi işimi kendim yaparım prensibini aştıracak kadar aklını değil. Obviously ki kavga ediyorlar. Sonra Kavar çok akıllıca bir şey dedi ki tamam kendi patronunu tut. Meyer de senin patronun olsun. Meyer açıktaki patronun olsun. Diğeri de gizlideki patronun olsun. Aynı anda ikisine sahip ol. Neden olmayasın ki dedi. Direkt art diyoruz. Ama üstünde bir şey daha dedi. Ne dedi? İşte hem bu Meyer'e sorarız. O da senin şu patronuna bir bakar. Neyi neseymiş daha iyi öğreniriz dedi. Bunu diyese Dana birden hayır kesinlikle hayır. İşte kesinlikle patronumun kim olduğunu anlamaya çalışmayacağız. Bu her şeyi riske atar. Bu çok yanlış bir şey olur, her şey mahvolur falan. Kvota yemin et dedi. Bana yemin et, ne yaparsan yap, benim Patreon'umun peşinden gitmeyeceksin dedi. Diyoruz ki güzelim, Kvot'un anasının babasının bütün trupunun ölümünden sorumlu olan bir insanın kimliğe çıkacaksa bile yapmasın mı bunu falan. Ama of course ikisi de bunun o esnada farkında değil. Çok kötü diyoruz. Yani o kadar kötü bir kısmı ki kitabın, hemen okuyalım bitsin modundayım. Kavada zaten pişman. Dana'yı düpedüz takip etti, dinledi falan böyle insanlarla konuşmasını. Normalde yapmam diyordu. Nasıl yapmayacaktın kanka? O da ayrı bir olay. Bu sefer kabul ediyor ama. Sonra böyle Dana şakayla karışık. Hani sadece bu mu? Sadece söz mü veriyorsun? İşte neyi kaybetmekten korkuyorsun? Kaybetmekten korktuğun şey üstüne yemin et. Benim için falan. Aşırı tehlikeli sularda yüzüyorlar. Burada bıraktıydık. Başlamadan önce diyecek bir şey var mı düşünüp geliyorum. My name and my power, I said. You are many things, she said dryly, but you're not taboo in the great. My good right hand, I suggested. Only one hand, she asked, playfulness creeping back into her tone. She reached out and took both of my hands in her own, turning them over and making a show of inspecting them closely. I like the left one better, she decided. Swear by that one, my good left hand, I asked dubiously. Fine, she said, all right, you're such a traditionalist. I swear I won't attempt to uncover your patron, I said bitterly. I swear it on my name and my power. Bunu okuyun bir yavaş ol. I swear it by my good left hand. I swear it by the ever moving moon. Tüylerim diken diken oldu. Then appeared at me closely, as if she wasn't sure if I was mocking her. Fine, she said with a shrug, picking up her harp. Consider me reassured. We started walking again, moving through the western gates and into the countryside. The silence between us stretched, starting to grow uncomfortable. Hani buradaki silence'ların da her birinde uncomfortable olduğunu göresiye, okuyasıya böyle bir rahatsız olmaya başlıyorum. Çünkü ana zamandaki Kvot'un sessizliklerden olan nefreti ve Kvot'tan yayılan sessizlik geliyor aklıma. Ama acaba aklımıza gelmesi gerekiyor. Hani şu an sıradan bir sessizlikten bahsediyor. Daha fazlası değil mi? Yoksa bir şekilde oraya bir gönderme var mı? Hani varsa bile çok normal geliyor bana. Şu an okuduğumuz yer bunu bir yere bağlayasım geldi. Okay. Things would grow awkward. I said the first thing that came to mind. So, are there any new men in your life? Are you enjoying your new position? Böyle Tyrion Lannister Tywin'e dizide diyordu. O geldi aklıma. Then I chuckled low in her throat. Now you sound like Master Ash. He's always asking after them. He doesn't think any of my suitors are good enough for me. I couldn't agree more, but decided it wouldn't be prudent to say so. And what does he think of me? What? She asked, confused. Oh, he doesn't know about you, she said. Why would he? I tried to give an unchallenged shrug, but I couldn't have been very convincing as she burst out laughing. Poor Kvothe, I'm teasing you. I only tell him about the ones that come prowling around, panting and sniffing like dogs. You're not like them. You've always been different. Not enough güzelim diyor yine de. I've always prided myself on my lack of panting and sniffing. Then I turned her shoulder and let her swinging heart bump me playfully. You know what I mean. They come and go with little gain or loss. You're the gold behind the windblown dross. Master Ash might think he has a right to know about my personal fears, my comings and goings, she scolded a bit, but he doesn't. I'm willing to concede some of that for now. She reached out and took hold of my upper arm possessively. But you're not part of the bargain, she said, her voice almost fierce. You're mine, mine alone. I don't intend to share you, Cadius. The momentary tension passed, and we walked the wide west road away from Severin, laughing and talking of small things. Half a mile past the city's last inn was a quiet patch of trees with a single tall graystone nestled in its center. We had found it while searching for wild strawberries, and it had become one of our favorite places to escape the noise and sting of the city. Then I sat at the base of the graystone and put her back against it. Then she brought her harp out of its case and pulled it close to her chest. Yani harp diyor, harp deyince benim aklıma çok büyük bir şey geliyor ama o kadar da büyük olması gerekmiyor sanırım. Causing her dress to gather and expose a scandalous amount of flesh. She arched an eyebrow at me and smirked as if she knew exactly what I was thinking. Nice harp, I said casually. She snorted in delicately. I sat where I was, sprawling comfortably on the long, cool grass. I tugged a few strands of it out of the ground and idly began to twist them together into a braid. Honestly, I was nervous. When we had spent a great deal of time together over the last month, I never heard Dana play anything of her own creation. We had sung together, and I knew she had a voice like honey on warm bread. I knew her fingers were sure, and she had a musician's timing. But writing a song isn't the same as playing one. But if hers wasn't any good, what would I say? Then I spread her fingers to the strings, and my worries faded to the background. I've always found something powerfully erotic about the way a woman puts her hands to a harp. She began a rolling glist down the strings from high to low. The sound of it was like hammers on bells, like water over stones, like bird song through the ear. She stopped and tuned the string, plucked, tuned. She struck a sharp chord, a hard chord, a lingering chord, and turned to look at me, flexing her fingers nervously. Are you ready? You're incredible, I said. I saw her flush a little, then brush her hair back to hide her reaction. Fool, I haven't played you anything yet. You're incredible all the same. Push. She struck a hard chord and let it fade into a quiet melody as it rose and fell. She spoke the introduction to her song. I was surprised at such a traditional opening. Surprised but pleased, old ways are best. Gather round and listen well, for I have a tale of tragedy to tell, as I sing of subtle shadows spread across a land and of the man who turned his hand toward the purpose few could bear. Fair Leonard, stripped of wife, of life, of pride. Leonard dediğimiz karakter şey değil mi diyor? Aslında. Neydi bunun adı? Haliax. Şunu bir bulup gelmeli. Okay, diyoruz. May your face be always held in shadow. Haliax'ın hikayesini anlatacak. Okay. Stripped of wife, of life, of pride. Still never from his purpose swayed. Who fought the tide and fell and was betrayed. At first it was her voice that caught my breath. Then it was the music. But before 10 lines had passed her lips, I was stunned for different reasons. She sang the story of Myrtilineus, Tyrrhenius' fall, of Leonard's betrayal. It was a story I had heard from Scarpe in Tarbia. But Lena's version was different. In her song, Leonard was painted in tragic tones, a hero wrongly used. A hero wrongly used ne demek düşünce? Selitos's words were cruel and biting. Myrtilineus a veteran that was better for the purifying fire. Leonard was no traitor but a fallen hero. Icarus gibi diyoruz. Ya da Tony Montana. So much depends upon where you stop a story and hers ended when Leonard was cursed by Selitos. It was the perfect ending for a tragedy. In her story, Leonard was wrong, misunderstood. Selitos was a tyrant, an insane monster who tore out his own eye, infuriated Leonard's clever trickery. It was dreadfully, painfully wrong. Despite this, it had the first glimmers of beauty to it. The chords well chosen, the rhyme subtle and strong. The song was very fresh, and there were rough patches aplenty. But I could feel the shape of it. I saw what it could become. It would turn men's minds. They would sing it for 100 years. You probably heard it. In fact, most folk have. She ended up calling it the Song of Seven Sorrows. Yes, then I composed it, and I was the first person to hear it played entire. As her last notes faded in the ear, then I lowered her hands, unwilling to meet my eye. I sat still and silent on the grass. For this to make sense, you need to understand something every musician knows. Singing a new song is a nervous thing. More than that, it's terrifying. It's like undressing for the first time in front of a new lover. It's a delicate moment. I needed to say something, a compliment, a command, a joke, a lie, anything was better than silence. But I couldn't have been more stunned if she had written a hymn praising the Duke of Gaibia. The shock was simply too much for me. I felt raw as reused parchment, as if every note of her song had been another flick of a knife, scraping until I was entirely blank and wordless. I looked down numbly at my hands. They still held the half-formed circle of green grass I'd been weaving when the song began. It was a broad, flat plate already beginning to curve into the shape of a ring. Okay, hatırlamıyorum ne diyordu ama bu şarkıyı yüzlerce yıl insanlar söyleyecek demedi deme tarzı bir şey derse ilk laf olarak olabildiğince az zararı çıkmış olacak denaylı olan iletişimin şiddetinde. Okay. Still looking down, I heard the rustle of Dana's curls as she moved. I needed to say something. I'd already waited too long. There was too much silence in the ear. Tam şu andaki silence, Kvot'un gerçek zamanda acısını çektiği silence'ın bir benzeri olabilir, but not sure. The city's name wasn't Miri Nightil. Keşke benim dediğimi deseydim bro. I said without looking up. It was not the worst thing I could have said. But it wasn't the right thing to say. There was a pause. What? Not Miri Nightil, I repeated. The city Leonard burned was Mirtelliniye. Sorry to tell you that. Changing a name is hard work. It will wreck the meter in a third of your verses. I was surprised at how quiet my voice was, how flat and dead it sounded in my own ears. I heard her draw a surprised breath. You heard the story before? I looked up at Dana, her expression excited. I nodded, still feeling oddly blank, empty, hollow as a dried gourd. What made you pick this for a song? I asked her. It wasn't the right thing to say either. I can't help but feel that if I'd said the right thing at that moment, everything would have turned out differently. But even now, after years of thinking, I can imagine what I could have said that might have made things right. Benim dediğim bro diyor. Bu şarkıyı yüzlerce yıl söyleyecekler diyecekti. Her excitement faded slightly. I found a version of it in an old book when I was doing genealogical research for my patron. Okay diyor. Bir şekilde Kvot'un araştırma yapmak istediği konulara yakın olduğu da belli. Hani aslında şu an Kvot'un yapmak istediği araştırmaya dair bir şeyler biliyor olabilir mi Dana? That's a possibility. She said, hardly anyone remembers it, so it's perfect for a song. It's not like the world needs another story about Orenville Saiter. I never make my mark repeating what other musicians have already hashed over 100 times before. Then I gave me a curious look. I thought I was going to be able to surprise you with something new. I never would have guessed you'd heard of Leonard. I heard it years ago, I said numbly, from an old storyteller in Tarbiye. If I had half your luck, then I shook her head in dismay. I had to piece it together out of 100 little scraps. She made a conciliatory gesture. Me and my patron, I should say. He is helped. Your patron, I said. I felt a spark of emotion when she mentioned him. Hollow as I was. Ha, bir şekilde bu derin duygusu hissetmesi sebebi birden Scarlett'in ilk defa hikaye dinlediği zamana geri fırladı. O sırada kendisi kod o gibi olduğu için tekrar şey mi oldu? O zamana döndü gibi mi oldu? Bir anda not sure. Hollow as I was, it was surprising how quickly the bitterness spread through my gut, as if someone had kindled a fire inside me. Bu o zamanlar kodken Chandler'in olayını da unuttuğu gibi sanki baştan sona bu durumda Chandler'ine dair bir şey duyması. Yok, bir dakika, lafı toparlayıp geliyorum. Toparlayamadım. Devam. Then another. He fancies himself a bit of a historian, she said. Böyle bir şey demiş miydi Brad'ın kendisi için? Buna bir bakıp geliyorum. Okay, baktım ama bir şey bulamadım. Sanırım kendisinden historian diye hiçbir yerde bahsetmemiş Brad'ın. She said, I think he's angling for a court appointment. He wouldn't be the first to ingratiate himself by shining a light on someone's long-lost heroic ancestor. Or maybe he's trying to invent a heroic ancestor for himself. That would explain the research we've been doing in old genealogies. She hesitated for a moment, biting her lips. The truth is, she said, as if confessing something. I half suspect the song is for Alberon himself. Nasır Eşes implied he is dealing with them here. She gave a mischievous grin. Who knows? Running in the circles you do. You might have already met my patron and not even known it. Braden amına koyayım diyoruz. My mind flickered over the hundreds of nobles and courtiers I'd met in passing over the last month. But it was hard to focus on their faces. The fire in my gut was spreading until my whole chest was full of it. But enough of this, then I said, waving her hands impatiently. She pushed her harp away and folded her legs to sit cross-legged on the grass. You're teasing me. What did you think of it? I looked down at my hands and idly fingered the flat braid of green grass I'd woven. It was smooth and cool between my fingers. I couldn't remember how I'd planned to join the ends together to form a ring. I know it's got some rough patches, I heard Dana say, her voice brimming with nervous excitement. I have to fix that name you mentioned, if you're sure it's the right one. The beginning is rough, and the seventh verse is a shambles, I know. I need to expand the battles and his relationship with Lyra, the ending knees tightening, but overall, what did you think? It şunu bir güzel diyeceksin değil mi kanka diyoruz. Once she smoothed it out, it will be brilliant. As good a song as my parents might have written, but that just made it worse. My hands were shaking, and I was amazed at how hard it was to make them stop. I looked away from them, up at Dana. Her nervous excitement faded when she saw my face. You're going to have to rework more than just a name. I tried to keep my voice calm. Leonard wasn't a hero. She looked at me oddly, as if she couldn't tell if I was making a joke. What? You got the whole thing wrong, I said. Leonard was a monster, a traitor. You need to change it. Oh, çok acı diyoruz. Then I tossed back her head and laughed. When I didn't join her, she cocked her head, puzzled. You're serious? I nodded. Dana's face went stiff. Her eyes narrowed and her mouth made a thin line. You have to be kidding. Her mouth worked silently for a moment. Then she shook her head. It wouldn't make any sense. The whole story falls apart if Leonard isn't a hero. It's not about what makes a good story, I said. It's about what's true. True, she looked at me incredulously. This is just some old folk story. None of the places are real. None of the people are real. You might as well get offended at me for coming up with a new verse for Tinker Tailor. I could feel words rising in my throat, hot as a chimney fire. I swallowed down hard against them. Some stories are just stories, I agreed, but not this one. It's not your fault. There is no way you could have. Oh, well, thank you, she said bitingly. I'm so glad this isn't my fault. Fine, I said sharply. It is your fault. You should have done more research. What do you know about the research I did? She demanded. You haven't the slightest idea. I've been all over the world, digging up pieces of this story. It was the same thing my father had done. He started writing a song about Leonard, but his research led him to the Chandrian. He'd spent years chasing down half-forgotten stories and digging up rumors. He wanted his song to tell the truth about them, and they had killed my entire troop to put an end to it. I looked down at the grass and thought about the secret I had kept for so long. I thought of the smell of blood and burning hair. I thought of rust and blue fire and the broken bodies of my parents. How would I explain something so huge and horrible? Where would I even begin? I could feel the secret deep inside me. Okay diyoruz. Bu bölüm neden bununla başladı? Chandrian bilgisiymiş. Bunun heart secret'ı, secret of the heart'ı. Ben ne dediydim? hatırlayıp geliyorum. Ben deney olan pişmanlığı dedim ama bu yani obviously. Huge and heavy as a stone. Buradan huge and heavy oluşu, stone'a benzeyişi, secret'in deep inside me oluşu falan direkt bölümün başındaki Tekam'ın laflarına gönderme. In a version of the story I heard, I said, touching the far edge of the secret, Leonard became one of the Chandrian. You should be careful. Some stories are dangerous. Deniz stared at me for a long moment. The Chandrian, she said incredulously. Then she laughed. It was not her usual delighted laugh. This was sharp and full of derision. What kind of a child are you? Bunu dedi ama ilk kitabın son kısımlarında beraber Chandrian'ın olduğunu fark ettiğinizde gayet panik halindeydiniz. Sonra sırf şu an incindiği için Kvot'un tepkisiyle Kvot'a rahatsız etmek için. Diyor ama Kvot bunu düşünemeyecek kadar iyi bir durumda değil şu an. İki insan birbirini yanlış anladığı için kötü bir yere varacak iletişimleri. I knew exactly how childish it made me sound. I felt myself flush hot with embarrassment. My whole body suddenly prickling with sweat. I opened my mouth to speak and it felt like cracking open the door of a furnace. I am like a child, I spat. What do you know about anything, you stupid? I must bit off the end of my tongue to keep from shooting the word whore. Oğlum çok kötü ya. Ben bu kadar kötü olduğunu unutmuşum buranın. You think you know everything, don't you? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. She demanded. You've been to the university, so you think the rest of us are. Quit looking for excuses to be upset and listen to me. I snapped. The words poured out of me like molten iron. You're having a snit like a spoiled little girl. Don't you dare, she jabbed a finger at me. Don't talk to me like I'm some sort of witless farm girl. I know things they don't teach at your precious university. Secret things. I'm not an idiot. You're acting like an idiot. I shouted so loudly. The words hurt my throat. You are shut up long enough to listen to me. I'm trying to help you. Then I sat in the center of a chilly silence. Her eyes were hard and flat. That's what it's all about, isn't it? She said coldly. Her fingers moved in her hair, every flick of her fingers stiff with irritation. She untied her braids, smoothed them out, then absentmindedly retied them in a different pattern. Bunların bir anlamı var ama bilmiyorum. You hate that I won't take your help. You can't stand that I won't let you fix every little thing in my life. Is that it? But maybe someone needs to fix your life, I snapped. You made a fair mess of it so far, haven't you? She continued to sit very still, her eyes furious. What makes you think you know anything about my life? I know you're so afraid of anyone getting close that you can't stay in the same bed 4 days in a row. I said, hardly knowing what I was saying anymore. Angry words poured out of me like blood from a wound. I know you live your whole life burning bridges behind you. I know you solve your problems by running. What makes you think your advice is worth one thin sliver of a damn anyway? Then I burst out. Half a year ago, you had one foot in the gutter, hair all shaggy and only three raggedy shirts. There isn't a noble in 100 miles of Imre that would piss on you if you were on fire. You had to run 1,000 miles to have a chance of a Peter. My face burned with shame at her mention of my three shirts, and I felt my temper flare hot again. You're right, of course, I said scathingly. You're much better off. I'm sure your patron will be perfectly happy to piss on you. Now we get to the heart of it, she said, throwing her hands up in the air. You don't like my patron because you could get me a better one. You don't like my song because it's different from the one you know. She reached for her hard case. Her mom is stiff and angry. You're just like all the rest. I'm trying to help you. You're trying to fix me. Dana said crisply as she put away her harp. You're trying to buy me, to arrange my life. You want to keep me like I'm your pet, like I'm your faithful dog. I never think of you as a dog, I said, giving her a bright and brittle smile. A dog knows how to listen. A dog has sense enough not to bite a hand that's trying to help. Our conversation spiraled downward from there. O yolum çok kötüydü. At this point in the story, I'm tempted to lie. To say I spoke these things in an uncontrollable rage. That I was overwhelmed with grief at the memory of my murdered family. I tempted to say I tasted plum and nutmeg, and I would have some excuse. But they were my words. In the end, I was the one who said those things, only me. Then I responded in kind, hurt and furious and sharp-tongued as myself. We were both proud and angry and filled with the unshakable certainty of youth. We said things we never would have said otherwise, and when we left, we did not live together. My temper was hot and bitter as a bar of molten iron. It seared at me as I walked all the way back to Severin. It burned as I made my way through the city and waited for the freight lifts. It smoldered as I stalked through the mayor's estates and slammed the door to my rooms behind me. Bölümün bittiğine emindim. It was only hours later that I cooled enough to regret my words. I thought of what I might have said to Dana. I thought of telling her of how my troop was killed, about the Chandrian. I decided I would write her a letter. I would explain it all, no matter how foolish or unbelievable it seemed. I brought out pen and ink and laid a sheet of fine white paper on a writing desk. I dipped the pen and tried to think of where I could begin. My parents had been killed when I was 11. It was an event so huge and horrifying, it had driven me nearly mad. In the years since, I had never told a soul of those events. I had never so much as whispered them in an empty room. It was a secret I had clutched so tightly for so long that when I dared think of it, it lay so heavy in my chest that I could barely breathe. I dipped the pen again, but no words came. I opened a bottle of wine, thinking it might loosen the secret inside me. Give me some finger hold I could use to pry it up. I drank until the room spun and the nib of the pen was crusted with dry ink. Hours later, the blank sheet still stared at me, and I beat my fist against the desk in fury and frustration, striking it so hard my hand bled. This is how heavy a secret can become. It can make blood flow easier than ink. Kate diyoruz. Bir tık Crow gibi oldu ama olsun. Chapter 74, Rumors. Kapatmadan önce diyecek bir şey var mı düşünüp geliyorum. Nope, hadi görüşürüz.